The biggest problem that we have to face as software developers is, to put it in a single word, change. Writing software for the first time, although it has its problems, is easy enough. But when users request new features or bug fixes or anything that changes their application, that's when things start to get tricky. And we've already seen with things like the solid code principles that those are really all addressed at producing software that is going to more easily be adapted and to change in a manageable way. Now, when we're dealing with databases, when we're dealing with entity framework connecting to a database, we have one fundamental problem in terms of change, that when we change our data structure, we are of necessity going to have to change it in two places, because we're going to have to change it in the C# class, and we're going to have to change it in the tables in the database. And so that's something that has been well catered for with the concept of code-first migration. So let's take a look at what that's all about. And if we look at the application that we've been using throughout this, it's still pretty much as it was. We've got the library that contains the DB context, and the entities, our book and our author. And then we've got a web application, and we've also got a console application. Now, I have made one slight change from last time in that we are no longer using SQLite. So if we look at the configuration here, you'll see that I'm now using SQL Server, and in my config file, in both cases, I've just got that set up to the local MS SQL local DB. The reason I've had to do that is because we're facing here a specific example of a general problem we have with Entity Framework, which is that Entity Framework, in terms of the software that you write in C#, allows you to be ignorant of the exact type of database you're dealing with. So you program in the same way, whether you're dealing with SQL Server, SQLite, Oracle, or whatever. However, that doesn't guarantee that every feature is available in every type of database. And so this feature, in terms of this code-first migration, does hit some problems in SQLite. Some of it you can do, but some of the more advanced features I'm going to show you aren't available. So that's why I've switched to SQL Server. So what we need to do is this. If we look at the way we did this the first time, what we had to create the database was, at this point, I said db.database.ensureCreated. And by doing that, it's simply the first time we came in here, it had a look to see if the database configured in that connection string already existed. If it did, fine. If it didn't, it created it. Another thing we can sometimes do actually here is there is also a database ensure deleted. And that will, if there is a database there, delete it. And so with that pair of them there, we're essentially guaranteeing that every time we run this application, we will get a brand new database, which can be useful in the early days of development and design and that sort of thing. But obviously in the long run, you're not going to want to do that delete. However, that in practice is probably not the best way to do it. That is not using this approach of migration. Migration allows us to create the database, and then as time goes by and we make changes to our entities, to have those changes pretty much automatically reflected in the database. Now, at the moment, we don't have a database at all. So we've got our entities, I've set up our connection string, but if we have a quick look at the SQL Server Object Explorer, we can see in that database, we don't have anything matching the books library that we have in the config file. So what I do here, again, just like we had with our scaffold DB context that we did for the code first from database, we go into the package manager console. And for that to work, we have to make sure that we'd included the NuGet package for Microsoft Identity Framework Core.tools. So that's what will give us the appropriate commands in the package manager console. A couple of other things we've got to do. One is we've got to make sure, in this case, we've got our website as the startup project, because it's going to be looking here in the startup class to determine where it's going to be putting this database based on what we've got there. And also, though, again, rather like when we used this before, the project itself has to be the project containing the DB context. So it gets its config information from the startup project, but it'll be reading the entities from whatever project we've got in there. And then all we do is we say add migration, And then we give the migration a name. And the name can be anything you like that gives you some kind of sense of what's going on. But because this is the very first migration, we will just call that, what's very commonly done, just call that initial create. And then if I hit return on that, we can see it's done a fair bit of work and it's generated inside the book library this folder called migrations. And in there, it has created a C# file containing a class with the name that we just gave it, initial create. And in here, it has put together all the code to actually create the database. So it's creating an authors table, a books table. It's chosen that ID is going to be the primary key, and it's chosen to have the foreign key constraint based on the author ID in the books table. All those things done for us. But it's only at this point generated that code. It hasn't actually generated the databases yet. If we just go in there and refresh that, still nothing changed. Because the second thing we have to do back in the Package Manager console is we say update database. And at that point, it reads what's in that initial create migration, and then it actually executes that. And this is where it needs to have the config information so it knows where to create the database. And if we give that a minute or two, we can see it's producing some SQL there. And now if we do a refresh over here, we've got our books library. And in the books library, we've got the tables for our two entity classes, authors and books. But we have a third table as well, and that's the migrations history. And if we just take a look in there, we can see that all it's really doing there is it's just put an ID, so it's got the name that we gave it, initial create, plus basically a timestamp in there, and also just a version number in case we upgrade the actual versions of Entity Framework Core as we go along. And as we do further migrations, that's going to build up. Now, at the moment, we haven't got any data in there, so let's just, now we've created the database, populate it, and that was done back in our console application. So if we just go into here, we're creating our fake data and all of that. So we'll run that. Doesn't display anything, but that should have worked. If we go back to here and just take a look at books, we can see then it's populated just as we had without the code first migration. But now let's make a change. So let's suppose we realized we need to add something. So if we go to our book and let's put into our book another property of type string, and we're going to call this genre. So whether it's science fiction, horror, whatever it may be. And then having done that, we need to do a further migration. I need to remember to change my startup project back to the web application, because that's got the correct config information, and also check that my default project is still a book library. And then I do another add migration, but this time I give it a name that's going to be informative as to what the migration is. So I might call that add genre. In many organizations, you might also choose to have a convention where you include maybe a change request number or something like that into that, whatever you like, just so you can keep track of it. But now if I allow that to run, you can see what it's done is put in a second migration. And if we take a look at that one, it's pretty simple that it's got this add column called genre to the table books of type string. So that's what needs to be done. Once again, though, it hasn't yet applied that to the database. So once again, we need to say update database. And that will now apply our genre. And again, we can see it generates the SQL. So if we go into here, and just to see these update, I actually have to close that table and then regenerate it. But now you can see that it's had this additional genre column it's put in there. Now, something you may have just caught sight of inside these migrations is that they have two methods. They have an up and a down. And that's what gives us really precise control, because the up is when we apply this migration that we wanted to add our new genre column. But what if we changed our minds? What if we wanted to roll back those changes? Well, we also have this down, which has a drop column, which, obviously enough, is doing the reverse. And so if we follow this for every change we make, not only are we applying changes from our code to the database, but we have it in a manageable way where if things go wrong, we can roll it back quite easily. And to roll it back, all we need to do is we need to say update database. But rather than just say that on its own, which is what we've done before, we need to specify the name of the migration that we want to roll back to. If you put nothing at all, it just goes for the latest one, so it would have gone for our genre. So if we put that on there, then we can see it goes through the same process, but now it has removed the migration. And actually, this was the thing that wouldn't have worked in SQLite. So SQLite, although you can use migrations to add features, it doesn't work for removing them. But that one does work in SQL Server. So again, now if we close that books data and display it again, you can see that it's lost the genre column. But it has not lost the data. So that's really nice. That means we can do this certainly on a development database, but even on a live database, a production database, we can make these changes in a way that's not going to destroy any existing data. One other command we have is, as well as the add migration, we've also got a remove migration. But if you think about what's happened there, remember the add migration only creates the class in here in your migrations folder. And similarly, the remove migration, if we said remove migration add genre, it doesn't have any effect on the database at all. It was the update database that changed the database. Doing the remove migration would simply have deleted this class here. So I won't do it because I still want to use that, but that's what it would have done. Let's roll that forward again. So if we just do another update database, then we should be back to where we were. But then what I'll also do, I could have done this in a program, but it's a bit easier to do it this way. I'm just going to put some values into that genre column. So we'll have classic for the three Jane Austens, and we'll have thriller for the three Ian Flemings. Okay, so that's the data put in there. Because what I then wanted to show you was a slightly more complicated type of migration. So if we go back to our book, let's suppose that although we want a genre in there, we realized that we didn't want to call it genre. That wasn't the appropriate word. And so we decided we're going to call this style of book. So rather than saying genre. Now, if I were to do that and then do a add migration, and we'll call this change genre name, and create the migration, you'll notice already it's giving us a warning that what it's done has a risk of loss of data. And if we apply that, so if I just do the update database, we'll see that now, if we look at the data, although it's got a style of book instead of a genre, we've lost the data that I put in there, that all of those are listed as null. And the reason it's done that is that if we take a look at the actual migration, so there's our change genre, we can see that all it's done is dropped the genre column and added the style of book column, which is all it could really do. It couldn't tell just by looking at the code that we've now got that that was a change of the name of the property, and therefore we want to change the name of the column, that it wasn't a deletion and an addition. So this is actually a circumstance where we don't just leave it to the add migration to correctly generate the code. This is why we're given code, because occasionally we might want to have to modify it. So the first thing we're going to do is roll that back. So let's do an update database back to add genre. So that does all of that. Unfortunately, although it's rolled it back, it can't recover the data. So again, if we look in here, we'll see it's got genre, but it's still null. So let me just do what I had before and put that back in so we can see that the next time it won't be lost. So we've got that back in there. And now what I'm going to do is go to the migration and actually rewrite it. So I would, in almost every case, still use the tool to generate the class and give me the basic shape of this. But we don't want to drop and add. We simply, on the up, want to say migration builder dot, and then we've got a rename column, which is what we want to do here. And the IntelliSense is telling us, first thing we have is the name of the column. So that was genre, that's the original name. Then we have slightly odd position for it, I think, but then we have the name of the table. So that was going to be our books table. And then we have the new name, which was what we wanted, just to make sure we get it right. Take that from there, style of book. Okay, so that's our rename. And then thing we've got to remember to do is, as well as doing the up, we've got to do the down. So let's take the same, but then just swap it around. So for going backwards, we are changing style of book back to genre. Okay, so that's the situation. Fairly straightforward. There will be more complicated ones, but that's where we've got to do some coding for ourselves in the migration object. Now, let's just do our update database. So remember the state of the database before. We had the genre and it had data. When we do the update database now, because it's done the change of name rather than the delete and create, we can now see that not only has it changed the column name, but it has preserved the data. And then one last thing to look at, if we just look at this migrations, we can see it's now got the three migrations we've put in there, and it would have been putting those forward, rolling them back as we did the update database commands. So that's a really nice way to keep things under control. If you're doing code first, you're not going to know from the beginning the complete structure of your database. So this way we can push changes out piecemeal. Sometimes it'll just work completely automatically when we issue the commands. Sometimes, as we've seen, you need to do things like do a rename and actually write some code in the migration for yourself. But it's a very powerful technique of how we can manage our database structure. So I hope that was helpful. Next time, we're going to be looking at some other features of Entity Framework Core, but hope you enjoyed that, and I'll see you soon.